Dear students, today we are going to study about the braking automatic brake system. So these are our apparatus. First we study about the hydraulic brake system. What is hydraulic? The braking system uses the brake fluid, okay, any type of fluid which used in the braking system, that's called hydraulic, okay. So this type of material used here, ethylene glycol, okay, to transmit pressure from the controlling unit, okay. I think it's better to study, we study with the animation, okay, about hydraulic braking system. So in the normal condition, the wheels are rotated like that. So at that time, no brakes applied. Okay. So you can see here, there is a brake pedal, and this blue color area is vacuum booster. That's master cylinder. Wait. Okay. Wait. Okay, here you can see this is vacuum booster, and here we call the master cylinder, this area. So here you can see there are two pistons, okay. This piston located in the master cylinder with the return spring, okay. So this is the reservoir. Here where the brake fluid store, okay. These orange color, these are the brake fluid lines, okay. So what, let's see, when the brake pedal is pressed, what will happen? Okay, now what is the function of this vacuum booster? Okay, so now we study this vacuum booster, this area separately, okay, by a photo we study this area separately. What is vacuum booster? Okay, okay, here you can see this is the brake pedal, okay, this is the push rod, and you can see here, okay, a poppet valve, okay, this is a poppet valve, this red color, this is the poppet valve, okay. So in the outside there is a, in the outside there is an atmosphere pressure, okay. Here you can see this is the brake, this blue color is brake booster pressure chamber. So this chamber contain the atmosphere pressure, I tell later, okay, I will tell later. Here this is the piston, this is yellow color, this is area is piston, and this black color is a diaphragm, okay. The work of this diaphragm is, okay, this diaphragm separate these two areas, okay, is not allow the air enter from this area to that area, okay. So this is separate, completely separate, that's a air seal. So work again, work as a air seal, okay. So this is the piston return spring. Here you can see that the same as, okay, these are the pistons, and this is a reservoir, this is a master cylinder, okay. Here you can see, when now this normal type, okay, okay, the normal time this poppet valve and poppet valve seat, this yellow color is poppet valve seat, and this is poppet valve, this both are touched, like this, okay. So there is no air gap, okay, which touched, okay. So this atmosphere air cannot enter like this because this totally touch, okay, connect each other. So this atmosphere air cannot enter. When you press the brake pedal, what will happen? This situation is now this brake pedal is pressed. So this poppet valve is moved this way little far away from the poppet valve seat. Okay, move. So you can see here there is a small gap. There is a small air gap. Okay, when you press the brake pedal, okay, this poppet valve is move far away. Okay, little far away. So this air, this atmosphere air come like this, enter like this. There is a gap here, you can see. Okay, enter like this. There is a gap. Okay, and this atmosphere air fill to this booster pressure chamber. This blue color area, this that's filled by the atmosphere air. Okay, so what is the purpose of this mechanism? Okay, just think, when we press the brake pedal, okay, it's give adding pressure, okay. We can easily press the brake pedal, okay. It is smooth brake pedal experience, okay. Because this atmosphere air also enter and it's give a force in this, okay, inside, and it also give the force, okay, adding force. There's a extra additional force, okay, additional force applied by the atmosphere air to this piston, okay. At the same time, this piston move very quickly, okay, okay. So it's a very quick response, okay. When we press the brake pedal, the brake of the four wheels is also get a quick response, okay. So we can any emergency or any conditions, okay, the brake also applied very quickly, okay, because of this poppet valve and the atmosphere air mechanism, okay. So you know already this type of return spring normally use the pistons move this way, okay. Then when we release the brake pedal, okay, what will happen? The return spring give a force to this side, okay. So this push rod and the whole thing arrive its previous or this earlier position, okay. And here you can see there is a pipe, okay. So this is a constant vacuum. When you press the brake pedal, this piston move this way, okay. That time this area also reduced, this volume is reduced, this vacuum. So some amount of some amount of pressure applied to this vacuum pipe, okay. When you press, okay, this sum of pressure applied into this vacuum pipe. So this the type of vacuum sources normally used for the engine operation. You already know the ignition vacuum advanced, this type of engine operations, this type of vacuum, because when you that means, okay, when you press the brake pedal, what will happen? The vehicle's deacceleration, okay, is going to deaccelerate, okay. So this according to the deacceleration, we can change the fuel supply, fuel quantity or anything, okay. So this type of vacuum source is used in the engine operation, okay. So that means we can reduce the pressure also this side, okay. Otherwise this compress this vacuum, constant vacuum area by this piston, sometime we can get any blast, okay, or damage, okay. So that extra pressure release through this vacuum source, okay. Here you can see this type of area I explained the animation, okay, reserve how it works, okay. I think now it is clear, this is a vacuum booster. these complexities we call the vacuum booster. Okay, this give the extra pressure for the brake pedaling operation, for the smooth operation. Okay, here you can see. So when we here there is a piston, let's move this word. So what will happen? There is a force applied by this vacuum advancer. There is a force applied from the vacuum advance. Okay, by a boosting force. Okay, some boost. It's normally we give the mechanical force, and this mechanical force boosted by this vacuum advance. So there is a force applied here. This piston rod. Okay, what will happen? This piston move. Okay, so now you can see. Normally this piston is cover this area when, okay, this is the starting position, initial position. When we press the brake pedal, what will happen? This push rod move like this. So this piston also move this way outward against the spring. This is the spring. This is the same as the return spring. So what will happen? This is starting position. Now this piston is moved to like this. Okay, so this open, this area is fully open. Okay, this is the opens from the fluid reservoir. Okay, now this is open, fully open. So what will happen? This path is totally open. Okay, so what will happen in braking condition? That brake fluid release from the reservoir. Okay, so normally this is compressed, normally it's compressed. Now this is open, suddenly open. This fluid is flowing under pressure. Okay, under pressure condition. Now the brake fluid is fill the whole line. Here you can see why these two lines. Normally, mostly in the cars, there are the two lines. Okay, this line is for example, the one line is for the front brakes. Okay, that's related to the both wheels, and this is for the rear. Okay, that's the back wheels. Okay, so then after it's going to here, and this is this line, this main line separated as two lines. Okay, because there are the two wheels in the front. Okay, and this lines also separate as other separate two lines, another two lines. Okay, here for an example they saw only one disc brake and one rear brake. Okay, in the normally the vehicles in the use the disc brake in the front wheel, always they in the vehicles use disc brake. Okay, in the rear wheel the vehicle use the drum brake or the disc brake. Okay, so we can see the two examples, one disc brake and one drum brake, how it works. Okay, so this is a disc brake, this is a side view of the disc brake. Okay, now you can see this is the vacuum this is a fluid pipe. Okay, pipe here you can see this is a disc. Okay, this is a disc, this disc. Okay, this is a side view. We can see the disc from this side. Okay, this way. Okay, so this is a rotor, this rotor. Here you can see these complete set. This is a black color or ash color. This complete set is we call the caliper. Okay, it's brake caliper. And here that blue color is the brake pad. Okay, brake pad. This is red color is the piston. Okay, brake piston. So here the fluid come like this. Okay, what will happen? The fluid fill this area, and in the fluid give a pressure this word the piston. So the piston moves this word. So what will happen? The piston is already touch with the brake pad. Okay, so according to the movement of the piston, this brake pad also move, okay, towards the disc rotor. Our task is this disc rotor is rotate, okay? This disc rotor is rotate. However, we have to stop the rotation, okay? By the friction, okay? The friction, okay? The friction applied between the, sorry, by applying this brake, the friction is generated, okay? Because of that friction, we can stop the wheel rotation, okay? Okay, now you can see clearly, wait, I play the animation. Now you can see how this fluid coming, it's filled and give the pressure. Okay, there is one piston used here, okay, only one side piston. So, okay, but first, what will happen? First, this piston move to touch here. So this caliper is normally is a flexible, okay, little bit flexible. So this caliper also move this and that words, okay. First the piston moves and touch the one side of the door rotor, one side surface of the rotor. Then what will happen? Then the caliper is moved, okay. Then this caliper is moved this way and this brake pad is grab or drop with this surface. So this is called, this type of piston arrangement is called, it's a float type, okay, float type piston. Here there are two types of piston you can see here. This is a disc brake. There are two types of disc brake. Here use the floating type. That's we already studied, okay, in the animation. This type of piston, so one fluid connection. First this piston move and grip with the rotor. Then what will happen? Then the caliper is move this word. It's a float type, okay. Then this pad is grip the surface of the rotor, okay. Here you can see, here there are two piston, okay. The pad are same and the floating type, only these pistons are available, okay. Here there are two pistons, here also another piston. So we need two separate lines, fluid lines, okay. The green color is fluid, so fluid come to fill with this piston area, and here there is a separate line, here also that fluid supply. What will happen? So this piston also move independently, this piston also move the independently, okay. So this type of here the caliper is fixed, okay. The caliper is fixed, only these pistons are moving, okay. Here only this piston moving and this side the caliper is moved and this is to grip with the rotor, okay. So here you can see multi piston, okay, multi piston. This is there are two piston. This type of piston apply pressure evenly means very uniform pressure. It's very balanced, we can balance the equally pressure, okay, here, because this side also and that side also they are same pressure or force applied here. But here the applied force is different, because here is applied by the piston, that area is applied by the movement of the caliper, okay. These type of multi piston used in the larger calibers, very large vehicle. But the single piston have lot of advantages. First, cheaper, okay, lighter, and small calibers. The small vehicle we can use this, and just as good for the everyday driving. The normal daily use we can suggest this type of floating type piston. Okay, clear. Okay, now we continue this animation. So now clear, okay, now this brake is clear. Next we study about a drum brake, okay. So now this drum brake is different because, okay, wait, This drum brake is different. Normally the drum brakes is like this, okay? This is the wheel, okay? There is a drum, okay? Here, inside of the drum, there is a two brake pad, okay? So, okay, this is inside of this wheel, okay? So, the disc brake, there is outside, okay? The disc brake, we can see that is outside, okay? But this is inside of drum, okay? It is fully covered. So, now let's see how it works. So, you can see here, there are two brake pads. You can see this black color two are. Here we, this drum brake we call, that's not a brake pad. This is called brake shoe, okay? These two are brake shoe, okay? There are two brake shoe like that. So, how this brake shoe work? This inside of drum. This is a brake shoe. This is other brake shoe, okay? So, the wheel is, this is wheel, okay? The normally the wheel is rotated like this, okay? That's clear. So when we press the brake, these two brake shoes are moved this way, okay? Extend, okay? It's enlarged, okay? Move this way. What will happen finally? Okay. Finally, this is touch fit inside of this, inside servet of this drum, okay? This is touch with this is surface, inside surface, okay? Inner surface. Okay, inside surface, these brake shoes are touched. Or gripped, firmly gripped, okay? What will happen? It move like this and this is, there is a friction, okay? There is a friction inside of this drum, okay? This move like this, okay? So, it's, here is gripped, okay? This brake shoe is gripped. So, what will happen? There is a friction applied this areas. Because of that, what will happen? This wheel rotation is going to stop. Okay. Okay, let's see. So, I have to tell. So, these are the arrangement, there is a spring, return spring, okay, this is stud, okay, I will explain later. Here you can see there is a cylinder, okay, this is a wheel cylinder we call. So, here that brake, okay, here also the red color, this both two are the pistons, okay, this we call the servo mechanism, this called this type of arrangement we call servo mechanism brake, okay, this red color is piston, okay. So this orange color is gap for the fluid, okay, brake fluid. So what will happen when this gap is filled by the brake fluid? What will happen? This brake fluid pressure. So there is a force apply this both side, okay, this side weight. So this piston moves this way and that way. So what will happen? There is a rod, okay, piston rod connected with this lever. Okay, this lever is connected with this brake shoe. So, the piston moves, the reverse also move this way, okay? So, what will happen? So, now you can see, there is a gap, this yellow area, there is a gap between the drum surface, inner surface and brake shoe, okay? When this piston is going to move, the outside, outwards, what will happen? This brake pad is also going to move and the brake pad touch with this surface, okay? So, then friction is generated because of that friction, this this wheel going to stop, okay? Now you can see, now wheel is rotated, okay, clearly? Now this fluid is coming, okay? Now the fluid is, okay? Because of that fluid, it stopped. I explain. Okay, now coming, now it's, the piston is moving, okay. Okay, generating friction, converting, okay, yeah. The kinetic energy, in the rotation, this wheel is rotated. So the kinetic energy is into heat energy. Because of the friction on the surfaces, what will happen? This heat energy produced, okay. They are, and they are stopping the wheel, okay. Okay. So we here, we have to study about the other thing. Wait. So what is, and the disc brakes have good stopping performance, huh? In the normally the brake disc brake have very good stopping performance, okay, than drum brakes, okay. So it's usually, this is very safer, usually safer and more efficient than the drum brakes, okay, disc brake. So and the other thing, you can see the disc brake, okay, when because of the friction generated on the rotor, okay, the disc brake rotor, okay, disc brake rotor, okay, the heat we already said, the heat produced, okay. So however the heat is produced, what will happen? Because of the continuous excess heat, okay, so two metal parts, okay, for an example the rotor surface and the brake pads, okay, because of the two heat, sometimes it may weld, okay, because of the two heat, high heat, excess heat, the brake pad, the rotor and the brake pad, okay, like this, the brake pad are weld each other, it may weld each other because of the high excess heat. So however we have to release or disperse the heat, okay. The every braking process, the heat is absorbed, okay. So we have a responsibility to release that heat, okay. So normally the brake pads are manufactured by the heat tolerant material. So mostly that means low melting point, this is not a high melting point. Oh, it can absorb the high amount of heat, okay. Use this type of material, okay, considering when manufacture the brake pad, okay, like this type of material, okay, Kevlar and cinder glass, okay. So the other thing, the rotor also have some vent or channels, okay, to release the heat, okay. So you can see here the arrangement, vent type of, okay, now it's a normal disc, okay, but you can see in the brake disc, you can see these type of arrangements, okay, the pad is applied both side, okay, this side and this side the brake pad is applied. So how this heat is released to atmosphere, okay, because of this vent, you can see there is a gap between the arrangement structure of this disc wheel is very different, it have lot of channels and vent, okay, here. So because of this arrangement, surface arrangement, this easily this heat is released from this rotor, okay. So that's called vent disc. So yes, already I told. So now we study some other videos, okay. Before that I have to tell one thing, okay. That is called self-adjuster mechanism. Okay. What is self-adjuster mechanism? Here you can see. Here we can call, there is a thread, okay? Okay, I will explain later this thread. Now we can, what is self-adjuster, okay? These type of arrangement you can see here, okay? This is the adjuster assembly, okay? This type of thing, adjuster assembly and adjuster lever. This is the adjuster lever spring, okay? Here there is a adjusting cable, okay? This cable is connected with this cable guide, okay? So what is the reason of this this complete set, okay? What is the this particular arrangement of these components, okay? What is the use or what is the function of this, okay? Let's see an arrangement. For an example, just you think, okay? Sometimes these brake pads may worn out, okay? For an example, this brake pad is worn out more than this brake pad, okay? So what will happen? The gaps, okay? In the gaps are not same, okay? Is this brake pad, normally for an example, this is a metal body and this is the brake pad surface, okay? After using, after it's because of friction, this what will happen? This layer is reduced, okay? This thickness is reduced, okay? Because of the friction, okay? After some time, okay? This is the one side brake pad, the other side brake pad is like this, okay? This is worn out, okay? Okay, this brake pad is worn out, okay? More than this brake pad, okay? More than this brake pad, okay? So what will happen? Okay. I explain like this, okay? This brake pad is this one and this brake pad I draw here, okay? So what will happen? This is the inner surface of the ram, okay? This right side brake pad is highly worn out, okay? So what will happen? The normal condition is brake pads like this, okay? This is highly worn out, so the gap is high. So this gap is low, okay? So when we press the brake pedal, what will happen? These two brake pads are more, these two brakes in the same rate, okay? The moving rate is same, okay? The moving distance is same, rate is same, okay? So what will happen? When we press, this brake pad is move this amount of distance, okay? That time, this brake pad also move this amount of distance, okay? So what will happen? This brake pad grip or touch with the drum surface, but this brake pad couldn't. Why? Because of the worn out, okay? The distance is high because of the surface worn out, okay? So this brake pad cannot move until the drum surface, okay? So what will happen? The one side brake is fully applied. This type of brake shoe is partially applied because it's not gripped firmly, okay? Just think. So these type of problems or issue we can overcome by this arrangement, okay? We can call this whole thing components called drum brake self adjuster. self, okay? It's automatically self IST, okay? Just we see an animation, then you can get it clearly. Okay, now you can see. So this is a brake pad. So this is a setup, okay? What will happen? This setup is total components connect the whole brake pad, this both brake pad, okay? So what will happen? When we pressed, okay. Return swing, okay. Self adjuster, okay. According to the worn out, okay, according to the both brake shoes, okay, this system is adjust, okay, adjust the distance, okay, distance of the movement, okay. That means when we press the brake pedal, this brake shoe is not move individually, okay, because of the gap here and here, because of the gap here and here, okay, the both side, this system allow the both brake pads to cover this area, okay, to cover this distance, okay, this distance, okay. So that's because of that it can achieve. So just think, okay, this is not move like this, okay, because this both brake shoes are controlled by this adjusting system, okay. So what will happen? This brake pads are sometimes move like this way or that way. However, this brake pads are firmly touch or grip with rub with this surface, okay. You can see clearly. This brake total brake shoe set is move this way or that way. To adjust the adjuster is cover this distance, okay. Cover this distance, okay. Now you can see, because of this arrangement here, you can see this is a self adjuster. There is a thread here, okay. So in the, because we can adjust this thread by the clockwise or counterclockwise, we can adjust this gaps, okay. We can extend, enlarge, okay, or reduce the brake pad and the between the gaps between the brake shoe, okay. So after some time, this brake pad shoes are getting worn out, okay. That time the brake pads needs to move more amount of the distance than the previous, okay, the new shoe, okay, because this worn out, so this layer also reduced, so this gap is increased, okay. What will happen? Because of that, we have to adjust the brake adjust the brake shoe arrangement, okay. expand or enlarge the brake shoe as arrangement. Okay, so when we adjust the thread, this is more is enlarged or reduced. Okay, so this manually we can adjust. At the same time, this also self, this also have the self adjustment. Okay. You can see this type of system. So this is called self adjuster. Okay, now we study about some extra things. Okay, extra things means practically we study about. Okay, first we disc brake. How we remove the disc brake? Okay, how we remove the brake pads? Okay, everything we can. Now here this is a disc rotor and disc pad. So here this man going to change the disc rotor and pads of his vehicle. Okay, let's see what are the steps we have to follow. So first he put the jack, okay, under the vehicle. So we have to lift the vehicle, okay, when removing the wheel. After removing the wheel, you can see, I already told, this is a rotor, you can see vent, here vent, this is a fluid line, this is a caliper. Inside of this caliper they are the brake pads. Okay, then so here you can see when removing this caliber, there is a two nut. One is upper nut, here there is a nut, and here also there are a nut. We can see just thing, if we remove this nut, what will happen? This nut is no need to remove. If, we can remove only one side nut, bolt. After we can open this caliber like this. Okay, this caliber is supported with only this nut, and we can open this caliber like this. The other way, we remove only this bolt. Okay, this bolt is remain as same. Okay, no need to remove. Then what will happen? We can remove the caliber this way. Okay, open like this. Okay, this is fixed and this is we can open. Okay, but the better way is, you can see there is a brake fluid connect with here. Okay, what will happen if we remove this bolt and we can open this caliper this way? Okay, this way, what will happen? This brake fluid pipe is pull. Okay, pull, because this move like this. Okay, this is this caliper supported with this bolt. We remove the caliper like this. What will happen? This fluid pipe is pulled or stretched. Okay, so that is not a proper way. So it's better to, you just think, we remove only this nut. We keep this nut. Okay, but and then open from this way. What will happen? So that time this fluid pipe is not stretched. Okay, like this, open like this, this fluid pipe is not stretched. Okay, so that's the thing he tell. Okay, there's a two nut. Okay, that is better. Best way, that is the best way. So what he left? He used that ratchet and loose this nut. Okay. Now loose this nut. Now pull out the caliper. So you can see clearly this is the vent and there are two brake pads. Okay. He also removed the brake pad. This is all the brake pad. Okay. Now then he closed the caliper and he put the bolt again. Okay. When we change the new brake pad, okay, we have to completely remove this caliper set. Okay. Okay. We need to completely remove the, we don't need to remove the caliper set. Okay. When we change the brake pad, don't need to remove the caliper set. Here, he need to change this router also. He changed the new router. Okay. That's why he removed this caliper. Okay. So, here there is a nut, two nuts. Okay. Behind the rotor, there is a two nut. This is called caliber rack. Okay. This caliber rack is fixed with this rotor. Behind the rotor, there is a two bolt. Okay. We have to remove that bolt. Okay. This is the one. That is the, we have to remove the complete caliper set because now we are going to change the rotor. So that nut, okay, you can see this and this nut. The caliper rack bolt, sorry, this bolt we have to remove. So now, okay, so we cannot remove this separately because this fluid line is kind of connected with this caliper. So he hang this caliper set by a rope, okay, with the support of this shock absorber ring, okay, this shock absorber ring, okay. He fixed this caliper set by a rope, okay. So this is because of this brake fluid line, okay. Now we require to remove the rotor, okay. He strike by the hammer to remove the rotor. Now the rotor is removed, okay. You can see there is so much friction, okay, inside the metal surface. So this is called anti-cheese, okay. Because of the high heat, okay, I already told, because of the excess heat, okay, this rotor and this surface may weld, okay. This weld means that's permanently fixed, okay. That's mean weld, okay. So when we that time when we strike the by the hammer, okay, is hard to separate or dismantle these two parts, okay. That's why, okay, prevent that seizing, okay, seizing, we use this anti-cheese cream, okay, here. This is the new rotor. So this is the cleaner. So it's cleaner because in the brake it's very important. If any dust or oily parts on the rotor surface, what will happen? This brake is not work efficiency and effectively. That's why we clean the rotor surface. Okay, that's very important. After fixed rotor, okay, he only fixed the one nut. Okay, now you can see this is called the thread locker. Okay, this called thread locker because of this bolt are related to the caliper. Okay, caliper rack. I already told on the back side of the rotor that these are the main two bolt fixed the caliper on the rotor. Okay, so because this type of thread locker cream use because in the high vibration, when the high vibration the vehicles running on the old condition the old condition of the road. Okay, you sometimes some service we can get high vibration, so that high vibration sometimes did this bolt may loose, move, get maybe loosen. Okay, that's why this thread locker, this cream prevent that this bolt thread, okay, this prevent the loosening. Okay, is prevent to prevent the bolt from loosening. Okay, that's why this thread locker use. Now it's fixed. Okay, the bottom nut also bolt also fixed. Okay, you use the ratchet. Okay, so now we are going to fix the new brake pads. Okay, here you can see before. So we remove that clips. That means this is called pad clips. Okay, the both side, the bottom and the above, there are the two clips. Okay, this is the called pad clips. Okay, here you can see. Okay, this is also anti cheese. Okay, here also then the anti cheese used. Okay, in the contact points between the brake clips and pads. Okay, that anti cheese is applied. You can see here. Okay, in the back side of the brake pad also the anti-cheese applied. I have to tell one thing here, the brake pad, you can see this type of clip. What is the use of this clip? Okay, this is the friction surface. Okay, after some time this friction surface layer is worn out. Okay, this is a side view. Okay, this is the friction surface. Okay, it's the back side of this brake pad, and there is a, this clip is like this. Okay, there is a clip. Okay, there is a clip. Okay, what is the use of this clip? You just think, after some time this brake pad is getting worn out. Okay, that means this layer is going to worn out. Okay, so now this brake pad is like this. Okay, so this is a indicator, this is a brake pad worn out indicator. That means these are a small metal plate. Okay, this brake pad layer is reduced below its range. Okay, this range, what will happen when we press the brake? This metal is touched with the rotor. Okay, this is the rotor. Okay, this is the rotor. The brake pads normally touch, this brake pad is, this is touch with the rotor. Okay, so this brake pad ready layer is worn out below this metal. What will happen when we, you press the brake? This metal part is touch with this rotor. Okay, so that time you can hear a sound. Okay, a different sound. Okay, that means rattling or some different kind of sound, because of this contact metal, this metal, and so that time you can realize my brake pads are worn out, or its duration, or its durable it's, we have to, that means we have to change the new brake pads. Okay, this lifetime is finished. Okay, this brake pad lifetime is finished, so we have to, so we don't need to remove and check the brake pad. Okay, this automatically indicated, this is the indicator, worn out wear indicator. Okay, brake pad wear, this one. Okay, the back side of the brake pad also applied. The pad clips, that's a new pad clip. He fixed up pad clips. Okay, remove the older pad clip and fix the new pad clip. Now you can see. Okay, here this is, there is no adjustment or setting in the disc brake. Okay, it's like the drum brake. We have to, I already told, there is a thread, we can adjust. Here there is no adjustment, it's automatically, naturally it's adjust. That means here there is, okay, this is the brake pad. Okay, after a particular time this brake pad is worn out. Okay, now this brake pad is like this. Okay, so when you, in the piston, this is the piston. Okay, this piston is moved this way, this Okay, this is the rotor. Okay, this is the rotor. This is the distance. The initial distance is very low. This is the initial distance. Now the distance is high. So, according to the distance, the new brake pad, okay, the pistons in the piston previous position is like this, okay. After some time, this brake pad is going to worn out, okay. What will happen? This piston also automatically move the outside, okay. And it is balanced, is push the brake pad this way, okay. However, this layer is reduced, okay. This layer is reduced, okay. Before the layer is like this, okay, reduced. So, however, this piston, there is a responsibility of this piston, is push the brake pad, okay, some little more, okay. Before no need, okay. So because of that, this piston also move from the outside, okay. After according to that, worn out condition, okay. This piston also okay gradually move this way, okay, to overcome this issue, okay. So this piston is self adjusted, okay, and finally it complete this brake process is fulfilled by this piston adjustment, okay. However, we have to cover this distance. Because of that, we have to move the brake pad more than the previous condition. So because of that, this piston also going to move than the its previous position, okay. So now we use the new brake pad, okay. New brake pad have the thicker surface, okay. So what are we going to do? We push this piston at its previous condition, okay. We have to push this one, okay. Otherwise we cannot fix the new brake pad, okay. So there is a tool used that's called compressing tool. We used the older brake pad, okay, to compress the piston. Now you can see how compress the piston move to inside. Now you can see the difference, okay. Piston move now is fit to the new brake pad. So now the new brake pad is fixed, okay. So there is a bolt, you can see, this is called guide pin, okay. Inside of this guide pin we can fix the nut, okay. Because of this guide pin, this caliper, I already told the floating type, okay. This caliper is move this way and that was flexibly because of this guide pin, okay. So he lubricate this guide pin by the grease, okay. Now we going to close the, okay. Now you can see, if we don't compress this piston, what will happen? We cannot close this caliper because the gap is not enough, okay, for the new brake pads. That's why we compress the piston. Now listen again, we fix the nut, okay, is in the nut is fixed into the guide pin, okay. Now tight. Now that is okay, complete. Okay, now let's see the here you can see, okay, in the side view rotor, this is the, you can see, guide pin, okay, this is the guide pin, everything you can see here. This is a side view of the disc brake, okay. Next we study about the drum brake. After loosening the nut, we can remove the drum, okay. By okay, by striking the camera, we can remove the drum, okay. Okay, now you can see this is the inside of the drum. This inside surface, on the surface, that brake shoes are applied, okay, against the friction. I already told, this is the wheel cylinder, okay, in the animation, okay. Inside of the other two pistons, these two pistons are moved this way and that way. So this is the brake shoe, okay. So there are some brake shoes. So here there are the self adjusting mechanism is here. It's not clear. So now what happened? He checked the brake shoe thickness, okay, by a measurement tool, okay. The thickness, he checked the thickness. That is correct. We don't need to change the brake shoes, okay. We can run the vehicle for some time with this brake shoe, okay. So no need. Now he remove the rubber, okay, of the cylinder, and he check the any oil leakage are there, okay. There is no oil leakage, okay. Check that the oil leakage. Because the brake fluid come here, and it's compress the area volume area, and it's push the piston outwards. Okay. So now it's a brake cleaner. Now he going to clean the brake, okay. He has some dirts and oily material, so he spray the brake cleaner and clean. The inner surface also, the surface of the drum also have to clean. Now we study how to adjust the manually adjust the brake. I already told this adjuster, this is auto adjusting, and another there is a wheel. Okay, I already told. Okay, when it happened, we adjust this thread clockwise. What will happen? This is expand. Okay, enlarge the enlarge both brake shoes. Okay. Okay, that the brake is not working properly or its grip properly. What is when you need to go in? This distance is not properly. We have to enlarge these two brake shoes. Okay, that's why there's adjustment. Oh, if the brake shoes are worn out, we have to adjust more. We need more enlargement. Okay, that's why he adjusts. Okay. After adjust, okay, he put the drum again. And he checked the brake, okay, by rotating. Is grip drop up firmly or not? Okay. If it is not, again, he. Change. Okay. You can see when the brake adjustment, we don't need to remove the drum. Okay, there is another way. Okay, that okay. In the back side of the drum, there is a hole. Okay, there is a hole. See. Okay. The back side of them, there is a hole. Okay. You can see this hole. Through this hole, we can see that thread, that adjuster thread. So we, okay, we put our screwdriver to this through this hole, and we can adjust the thread. Okay. Without removing the drum, okay. You can see. Okay. And the other thing I have to tell here, okay, when you change the new brake pad or brake shoe, or you remove the fluid line, okay, fluid line, okay, or you remove the new brake pad or shoe, okay, sometime. This is a four wheel, okay. This is your four wheel, okay. Sometimes the air bubble, okay, in the fluid line. This is the reservoir. Is come to through this. There is a master cylinder. This brake line separated to separator. This is to a front wheel. This is a rear wheel, okay. Sometimes if you remove this cable fluid pipe or you change a new brake pad, sometime it may, oh, you can see the difference. Okay, in the pedal you can see the accelerator pedal and the clutch pedal is very smooth, okay, but the brake pedal is very hard. Okay, the normal condition you can check the standard brake pedal is, when you press the brake pedal, you feel very hard. Okay, that means inside of this pipe, okay, only the pipe, the only inside of this pipe only the fluid is located. There is no air bubble. If any air bubble here, okay, this fluid is pressure is not work properly. Okay, not work properly. What will happen? So you cannot feel. You cannot feel any hardness. Okay. On this brake pad, okay, that means there are some air bubbles inside of this system. Okay, now see how we remove these air bubbles. Okay, in the every brake system you can see these type of nipple. Okay, bleeder screw. Okay, this I think this you used the 8 number wrench, I think so. We remove this, we lose this nut, okay? Okay, we lose this nut, what will happen? This fluid, okay? Fluid, the brake fluid is released from this, okay? Nipple, okay? We can eliminate, we can eliminate the brake fluid, okay? So normal time it's night is tightened. Okay, so the process is, okay, after you fill up the brake fluid, okay, here reservoir, the 1% press the brake pedal. Okay, the you fix the vehicle on the ramp and you lift the ramp. Okay, you lift the ramp, in the front seat there is a person. He press the, okay, he press the brake pedal. Okay, that time after he pressing some time, okay, after pressing some time he hold the brake pedal. Okay, he hold the brake pedal. Okay, he push the brake pedal and hold of few seconds, few moment. That time the another person, he loosen this nut. Okay, loosen this nut, what will happen? The brake fluid is eliminated. So there are two or three times we have to do this same process in one wheel, and other thing we have to do one by one for each every wheel. Every wheel we have to do one by one. Okay, two or three times we remove the fluid. That what happened when we the big there as air bubbles also eliminated with this fluid. Okay, so the this four wheel have, if this is a drum or drum brake or disc brake, whatever they are, you can see this type of nipple. Okay, you loosening this nut, that time that's eliminate. So you have to do the all four wheels. Okay, after you can feel the hardness. Okay, if there is no bubbles in the system, you can feel, see, you can see after complete this process you can feel the hardness on the brake pad. Okay, then we can check the reservoir. Sometimes mostly we have some amount of fluid is eliminated from the system, so we have to add the brake fluid at the particular level. So this is the hydraulic. Okay, so I clearly explain the hydraulic system. So under the hydraulic system I explain lot of things. Okay, lot of things and practical, these things are not in the theory but the practical things. Okay, I thought so disc brake and the drum brake I completed. Next we study about the pneumatic or air brake system. Okay, so what is pneumatic system? Okay, we already studied about the hydraulic system, that's yeah, the brake fluid used in the hydraulic system. So here the pneumatic system, okay, mostly used in the heavy vehicle, okay, for an example truck or trailers, bus, okay. Here the compressed air used instead of hydraulic fluid, okay. Here compressed air used, okay. So how the compressed air, actually in the compressed air taken from the environment, okay, drawing the cleaning air from the environment, okay, then it is gone through the compressor where the air fully compressed and finally is stored into high pressure tank, okay, about 120 psi, okay. So this is the process of the air stored in the pressure tank, okay. Normally, okay, moreover, these type of air pneumatic functions, air function, normally air operated secondary functions normally occur take place in other system, for an example gearbox shift control, okay, and clutch pedal, air assistance servo. That means this type of air used for our any mechanical operations. This air assist the mechanical operations and it give a smooth operation, it give a additional force, okay, by air. So here we can get the smooth shift, gearbox shift control and clutch pedal operations, okay. Now we come to brake system, okay. So in the brake system there are two types of brakes, okay, normally in the pneumatic system, okay. First is parking brake, okay. Then other brake is normal working brake, that's trailer brake circuit, that's a normal working brake, and other is parking brake, okay. So there are two separate circuit, okay, used in the pneumatic system, okay. That means there are two brake circuits used, okay, for first is divided two brake circuits, okay. One is parking brake, other is trailer brake or working brake, okay. It's normal way we press the brake for stop the vehicle. So this working brake and parking brake, okay. And then is divided to working brake divided to again is two circuit. This is a for front wheels, okay, front pair wheel or front wheels. This is rear backside wheel, okay. Backside wheel, okay. Again parking brake, mostly in the parking brakes are available in the rear brake, okay. Okay, rear system. So it's dependent on the parking brake, depend on the brake. Sometimes some trailers or the bus trailers, mean I already told you, they are separate. This is the prime mover, the vehicle. They are a separate container connect here, okay. This is the flexible, okay, connection. This is a separate connect. This is prime mover, this is trailer, okay. It's depend on this type of vehicle, we need separate parking brake, okay. Here also we need the parking brake, and the prime mover also need the parking brake, because if we separate this connection, okay, that time we need individual parking brakes, okay. So it's depend on the vehicle. The normal vehicle, the bus normally it's only rear brake, okay, parking brake used in the rear side, okay. So it depend on the vehicle, okay, front or rear, it's depend on the vehicle. So each parking and working brake again is divided to front and rear wheel brakes. So the each system have separate circuit, okay. That mean separate air pressure tank, separate line, okay. No, not the air pressure tank, not the separate lines, okay? Because just think, if in the front, if the parking brake and working brake are in the parking brake and working brake located in a same line, okay? So same air line or pneumatic line, okay? What will happen? If any leakage on the line, the parking, both parking brake and working brake not working at the same time. For the safety purpose, these are divided by different two circuit, okay, airline circuit. So if the working brake is suffer by under any repair or any leakage, we can use the parking brake circuit, okay, we can stop the vehicle by using the parking brake lever, okay, that's why. And the other same thing, there are two, again it's divided to rear air and front wheel, okay, this is both are separated, okay. So if the rear wheels, any issues in the rear wheel circuit, we can use the front wheel brakes, okay. These also are divided in the different circuits, various circuits, because of the safety, okay. That's clear to all, okay. There are separate two service brake circuits, okay, for parking brake and trailer brake. Again is the two circuits again separated into front and rear wheel circuit, okay. So okay, they are individual tanks, okay. Here in the front wheel and rear wheel also have the individual tanks, okay. So just think, here also individual tank, here air pressure tank, okay. If any issues or any leakage in the tank, only in the front wheel is not working, but we can stop the vehicle by using the rear wheel, okay. Oh, that's not separate, there is a one clutch, one rear brake pedal, but when we press the brake pedal, only this front wheel is not working, front brake is not working because of the leakage, but however this rear wheel is working, okay. If we form a single tank, what will happen? If there any leakage in the tank, both brakes are not working at that time, okay, because of this safety issue, they divided this system, okay. Okay, here we study, so how the parking brake have a heavy spring, okay. I will explain with the animation, that is very clear for you, how the pneumatic brake working, okay. Let's see. So here you can see, now this is the parking brake, we have two switch, okay, a different, okay, parking brake, okay. That means you can see this is same as the drum brake, okay. This is also drum, they are a drum brake shoe. Here especially you can see like a form of S design, this is called S cam, you already know the cam shaft in the engine. So what will happen, according to the rotation of partially rotated this cam, this word or that word, according to that this brake shoe is move this word or that word, okay. It can control the two-way direction, this cam, this is a this in the red color totally is called cam, okay. So there is a linkage and this is the push rod, and here we call this is the air chamber, brake air chamber, okay. this type of chamber, the every wheels have this type of chamber, okay? Every wheel have separate wheel chamber, okay? Just think, here there's a pressure tank, okay? The pressure tank connection is come to like this, okay? This is a one line. There are some other devices are there between that pressure regulator or something. Don't think about this. We study about the basic process, okay? So there are two already told. Here this air chamber divided into two separate rooms, okay? Here you can say very heavy and thickness springs, okay? This area we call, this is related to for parking brake, okay? Here this is for normal working brake, okay? Both the have the both spring, but here the parking brake have the heavy spring. Then how it works, okay? In the normal time, okay, wait, this is the normal time, okay? This time what will happen? Normal time this spring is in a flexible mode or normal, okay, without any twist or okay, without pressure. This spring is in normal mode. That time, okay, this vehicle is in a parking mode, okay? Because when the push rod is move this word, what will happen? This brake is going to lock, okay? This move into inside, okay? What will happen? In the brake shoe is released and it's remains at the normal position, okay? Yes, sir. So now what happened? Now this spring push this rod, push this rod, okay? Because of the spring, okay? So now the brakes, wheels are locked by this brake shoe, okay? So the when the parking brake time, the springs are normally is expand, okay? The spring are expand, okay? However, when we have to compress this spring, this word, okay, this push rod also move this direction, that time we release the parking brake, okay? How it achieve, okay? So we have to give a air supply here. So this black color is a diaphragm. So we give a air supply. Because of the air pressure, the diaphragm move against the spring, okay? For a reaction, this diaphragm is moved to here. This diaphragm is, that's why what happened, the push rod also move this way, okay? So that time, so we need the air supply here, okay? You can see here now air is, okay, this yellow color is here, okay? So this time you can see the gap, okay? So that brake shoe is released, so now the vehicle is working. So this, okay, so now we did the same thing. There's another diagram, okay? You can see this room, okay? Here is a working brake, okay? So this is different, okay? When this spring is compressed, what will happen? The brake is released. But here that's opposite. When this spring is compressed, what will happen? This push rod, because this side diaphragm, okay, air come to through this port, okay, and is push the diaphragm this way, okay? So that time what happened, this rod move this way, that time the brakes going to lock, okay? So When the air enters this chamber room, what will happen? This rod move this way, that time air rod. And the air again releases from this air chamber. Okay, again this spring, the return spring come to its previous or earlier position. That time the brakes, when we press the brake pedal, this is brake pedal. Okay, when we press the brake pedal, what will happen? The air enters to this room. This diaphragm with spring move this way. That time the brake going to apply. Okay, when we release the brake pedal, okay, when the brake pedal going to upwards, so that time the air is not come to inside. Okay, okay, the so that air come not come to inside. Okay, that air pressure is reduced, so that time the spring, okay, because of the spring, okay, so stiffness or compression, okay, the spring move again to its previous position. Okay, that time this brake release. Okay, okay, now it's a brake is applied. So the same time the normal condition, okay, without the parking brake condition, this chamber is totally filled by the air. Okay, this air is filled by air. Okay, the parking brakes condition, the air going to release. Okay, the air going to release. Okay, so here you can see this brake is working as a separate, okay, separate rod. They are not, when the parking brake is applied, okay, the air release. Okay, not this way, there is another way, I think this type of way. Okay, release. That time this push rod is, move this way, and push rod touch with diaphragm, and it's working at the same, okay, this working as the same rod when the parking condition. Okay, this rod also push this diaphragm and this rod assembled. Okay, but in the when the working brake condition, the working only in this working brake is working individually. Okay, but in the parking brake condition, this parking brake touch with this diaphragm and this whole set working at the same time. Okay, okay, now is normal brake. So before I check the parking brake, do check parking brake time, you can say the see the push rod. Okay, the both system are working on. Okay, but in the working brake condition, only that push rod working. Okay, so here you can see in the buses. Okay, when the driver stop the bus, okay, when the driver stop the bus, when you are traveling time, you can observe sounds. That sound, there are some air released from the bus, there is a sound, it's okay, that sound. So you can think that type of sound, you can observe, okay, in the vehicle. So you can surely tell that type of vehicles work under the pneumatic brake. Because why that type of sound you can observe? What is the reason? Is this is a normal condition when the driver stop the vehicle. Okay, so what is the process? Then he pull the handbrake. Okay, handbrake. Okay, when stopping condition. So the handbrake condition normal time, this is filled with the air. Okay, so the handbrake condition, the air, we need to release this air. Okay, the outside. Okay, so the air is released through this valve. Okay, it's outside. That time the spring work, spring with the push rod move this way. Okay, so because of this air release, from the environment. So sorry, from not to the environment. Okay, you can heard that sound. Okay, the air, that is air release sound. Okay, so then normally in the buses, okay, they apply the handbrake. Okay, parking brake. You can see the air releasing sound. Okay, the reason is this. Okay. Now working brake, normal brake when the press the brake pedal. So now you can see clearly the cam, how this cam is working. Okay. Okay. And then this is also same as so when the AR is this is the normal brake, okay, working brake. Okay, so this is the actual air brake chamber. This red color is a parking brake spring. That's very heavy, heavier than normal brake. Okay. Now piggyback. Piggyback hole. That's a area of backside. That means a parking brake. Okay. Here is emergency. Emergency air inlet. When the now normal time, these springs are expand. So this condition is parking brake. Okay, when we release the now this is a this apply of parking brake. When release the parking brake, what will happen? The orange color AR is enter, so AR is compressed against the spring. Okay, that time and AR. Okay. Okay. So normally how is electronically is work, okay, when we pull the parking brake, okay, so the signal come to the brake relay valve. Okay, there are two. One is okay, so one is brake pedal air valve. Okay, one is brake pedal air valve and another is the brake hand control, the parking brake. Okay, when we apply the parking brake or we apply the brake pedal, okay, the air valve and this control, you need send the signal to relay valve. Okay, relay valve. So the relay valve is get a signal. What happened? The relay valve allow the air to the system. Okay. So the relay valve is like working as a switch, on off switch. Okay, so on the compressor, I already told before that air arrived to tank, air pressure tank, the compressor, where the compressor, where the air going to fully compressed. Okay, so on the, this compressor is like AC compressor, air the compressor is driven off the automobile engine. Okay, the cranks are fully or free through the belt or the engine timing gears. Okay, the compressor is connected directly with the same as the other things. Okay, this is a crank pulley is connected with the belt. Okay, so this is also same as the this compressor also lubricated and cooled by the engine lubrication and cooling system. Okay, next we this already studied the drum brake and disc brake also we study in the hydraulic unit. Okay, next we study about the anti-lock brake system. What is ABS? Okay, anti-lock brake system. It's better to we study with an animation. Okay. In the normal brake without ABS, what will happen? When we apply the brake, okay? When we apply the brake, that this brake is totally locked, okay? That without rotating is totally locked. What happened? If the four wheels of car is totally not rotated, is locked, okay? What will happen? They are the surface, okay? So, in the wheel is slip, okay? The wheel is slip, okay? But without rotating, okay? Without rotation, the car is going to slip, okay? Slip, okay? Without this rotation, the car is going to slip, okay? So, what will happen? We cannot control the car because the only in the wheels are rotating, we can control the car, okay? Now, out of control because the car is moving, okay? The car is moving without rotating the wheel, okay? Slipping, okay? Slipping, but that, so that time we cannot control any, we can, the accelerator also we cannot move, okay? It's totally slipping. So, what happened? The ABS, without the ABS, you can see the surface, okay? This type of oil is ABS. We suddenly press the slipping, or we suddenly press the brake, what will happen? The cars are, yeah means that is rotated like this, okay? Because of the slippage. So now we study about the basic principle. When we press the brake pedal, this wheel is totally locked, okay? That time no rotates, okay? So the normal time, the frictional force is applied this word. So first we study about the basic forces, okay? In the normal condition, the wheel is rotating, okay? It's rotating without any slip. That means without any slip, because in the contact point is between the rod and the tire, contact point is this, okay? This is the contact point, okay? So if any forces apply in this point, what will happen? The guard going car is affected by a resultant force, okay, in the contact point. What will happen? The car will slip, okay? So the normal condition, the car running without slip, that means in the contact points, there is no forces, that's not, the force apply in the contact point is zero, okay? That's why this car is working without slip, okay? Without any slippage, because of this force is zero, okay? So how this force is going to zero? Velocity zero, this I already told. Now you can see there are two forces, okay? When the vehicle rotate, there are two kind of motions, okay? One is the rotational motion of the axis, okay? And other is the straight motion, okay? This one, okay? So how the velocity? Okay, so here, this rotational velocity is, we can divide it here, this word, and it's rotated like this, okay? Here, so this rotational velocity is applied this word, okay? Rotational velocity they apply this word. At the same time, in the straight motion is this word, okay? So this both force are equal. So here, the velocity is, so this velocity is zero, okay? That's why the normal time, the car wheels rotate without any slippage. Okay. So, right. So now we just analyze about the when driving a turning point. Okay, we turn the car. Okay, we turn the car. In a turning point, what will happen about this force? Okay. Okay, that is time the wheels rotate like this. Not rotate, sorry, wheel turn like this. So when the rotation force velocity is applied this way. Okay. So this time we press the brake. Okay. This time we press the brake, what will happen? The translation of velocity is apply this word, okay? So, however, the car, when we press the brake, however car is moved this word, okay? Because of translation velocity is apply this direction, rotational velocity apply because of the turn of the tire. Wheel is transfer rotation and velocity apply this way. That time we cannot say the this point contact point velocity is not zero. Okay, because the both forces are not opposite direction. Okay, it will be inclined. Okay. So what will happen? This time in the turning point or any time we press. Okay, this is the correct. Okay, if we change the translation of force to this direction, okay, this car is not going to slip. Slippage. Okay, it's going to slip. Why? Because now zero. Okay, but in the normal time, the normal brake time. The translational force is applied this direction. Okay, that time the force is not balanced. So what happened? There the slippage is going to occur. Okay, if the forces are applied the opposite direction, what happened? We can turn the car without any slippage. Okay. If the forces are applied like this, okay, we can turn the car very easily without any slippage. Okay. Steering with braking. That means okay. When we turn the steering at the same time, okay, at the same time we apply the brake, what will happen? Rotation force is this word, translation force velocity is this word. Okay, so what happen? We cannot use the steering with braking. Okay, the normal brake, what happen? The vehicle fall into any accident. Okay, okay, we cannot control the vehicle when braking. We cannot use the steering. Okay, and this is other condition. You can see the four wheels are not contacted with the same surfaces. Okay, the other two wheels are the normal road condition. These two wheels are, this is the oily or some other, okay, materials. Okay, so here this surface is different than the other wheels. Okay, so what will happen? that time we cannot tell in the both speed in the four wheel velocity of these four wheels are not same, okay, because of the contact surfaces and friction, okay, friction here, okay, we can get we are here lower friction, okay. So what happened, the friction is very low, so this surface is not same, okay. So what happened, the four wheels velocity and velocity is not same, so this car is going to means just rotates, okay. So that time a torque is applied, okay, because the resultant torque is applied, the all forces are not balanced, okay, that time a torque is applied, resultant torque is this one, so the car is okay. Oh, torque is okay, the four wheel speed is not same, that's why the torque is resultant torque is applied. So how we overcome this issue, by using anti-lock brake system, okay. So now you are clear, okay. However, the two things we can understand here, the first thing, we cannot hold these four wheels wheels for a long time, okay, for a prolonged period we cannot hold this wheel, that means we hold this wheel means without rotating, okay, we cannot hold this four wheel without rotating, it may what happen without rotating this whole wheel, what is happen, the car is going to slippage, okay, going to slip, okay. So however, we cannot stop this wheel rotation for a long time, we cannot, okay. And the other thing, we must maintain these four wheels velocities as same, okay, the four wheels velocity we have to maintain as same value, okay. If it is not, what happened, there is a resultant torque applied here, so the vehicle is will okay. So what is the, however we cannot hold this vehicle rotation for a long time, that means there is a one way, we can hold the brake and release, hold release. So what happened, this wheel is partially rotate and hold, okay, rotate hold. So we press the brake, this means we push the brake pedal, okay, very fastly without the irregular intervals, okay, push and release and push and release, okay. That time what happened, the totally in this brake is not locked for a long time, so we can avoid the slippage. So now you can see how it adds in the ABS system, and the four wheels have the speed sensor here, okay, this red color, this the four wheels have the speed sensor, and every time this speed sensor measure the wheel velocity of the wheel, okay, okay. So the next thing is we have to maintain the same velocity at four wheels, okay. So what happened, this sensor send the velocity measurement to the ECU, then ECU control this is the modular unit, okay, yes, modular unit, okay, because of the speed, okay, because of the speed, okay. So this speed sensor four wheels, okay, the sensors send the signal to ECU, then ECU decided, okay, this is you decided that is speed differences. Okay, then ECU send the signal to this modular unit. So in the modular unit calculated how it partially released the brake pressure, okay, the fluid or air by using the partially is separate is okay, it's control the four brakes separately, okay, separate line. So gives you the separate control, okay, that means the partial release and okay hold and release, okay, it's finally it is separately controlled and finally okay it maintain this modular controller maintains its all four wheels the speed as same, okay, the same value, okay. At the same time, because of the partially locking and releasing pressure, okay, these wheels also not totally completely lock out, okay, the wheels also partially rotated because of the modular. So the two works are doing here, one is maintain the four wheels as the same speed and the is allow the wheels to partially rotate, okay. So this is the ABS system. Because of that we can overcome the slippage in the vehicle, okay. I play again, yes, you can. Okay. When the turning point, we can use the steering without any problems. Okay. Okay. And you can see, you also think, without ABS, the brake, the wheels are hold for a long time. So you can think, without ABS, we can stop the car. Okay. More. The distance is, the stopping distance is okay, this is ABS and this is your imagination is like this, okay. Okay, without ABS you think the car, we can stop the car before the position distance, okay, that is before the ABS, okay, ABS distance, okay. Because we hold this wheel for a long time, okay, but here we hold and release, okay, but not like that, okay, but reality is not like that, okay. I give the clear explanation because the ABS is very effective, okay, ABS is very effective than without ABS, okay. So by holding and releasing operation we can stop the vehicle very effectively and efficiently, okay, the distance also that the without ABS. How it achieved, okay, in the normal condition, in the proper rotating working condition of the tire, okay, the normal condition, the coefficient of friction, okay, the normal proper condition, the coefficient of friction is zero, okay. Here you can see this side, y axis is coefficient of friction, x axis is slip ratio, that means this is okay, 0.5 mean this wheels is 50% slip, okay, is rotated properly in the 50% and the 50% is slipping, okay. This one means 100% is totally slip, going to slipping, okay, okay, this is 50%, 0 it's going to 1 2 3 4 and this is 50 and this is 100%, okay, slip way, okay. So now it's a normal working condition, there is 0, okay, the coefficient of friction also 0, but If the wheel is rotated, is 100% is okay when is 100% is it's slippage, okay, it's sliding, okay, 100%, okay, the value of stress burden, okay, is totally, that means totally sliding, okay, or slippage. That time what happened? The graph is like this, okay, normal theory graph is like this, okay. So normally these conditions about 50% to 100 slippage, okay, this time we can absorb high coefficient of friction, okay. But this is the theoretically, because here the material is depend on this coefficient of friction, okay, between the rod and the tire, okay, the friction apply because of the properties of material of this material, okay, here we use the tire, okay, because of the tire this is the normal value, it's ideal, okay, this is ideal graph, but because of the tire we, it's okay, we practically get because of the deformation, okay, when the tire is deformation we cannot get that graph. Actually we get the graph, the actual graph is we like this, okay, the practically because of the tire material, the deformation of the tire, we can get the slippage or sliding friction graph like this, okay. So now you can see when, what time we can get the high coefficient of friction. Here it's around 0.12 rate, slip rate, that means I already, this is 100, so this is 12%, okay, when the wheel is sliding in 12%, okay, when the wheel face the 12% sliding, okay, we can get the high friction. High friction, what is friction? The friction is the stopping rate, okay, we okay the wheel is rotated like this, so friction is apply this, okay, when the high friction, the friction is opposed the vehicle's movement, okay, movement, okay, if the high friction material we can, okay, if in the high pressure friction is applied, what will happen? We can stop the vehicle very quickly and very early, okay, because of the high friction, okay. So when we get the high friction here, okay, when the this wheel slipping or sliding in the value of 12% slip, okay, 12% slipping, okay, we can stop the car very quickly than the other slip, okay. Okay, so when we press the brake, okay, when we press the brake pedal, okay, in the 12% slipping will be applied on the wheel, that means that time we can stop the vehicle very effectively, okay, okay, when a smaller distance we can, okay, when short distance we can stop the car, okay, when the 12% slip, okay. So these type of an, okay, so however when we press the brake, okay, and this total brake system need to or require to maintain the wheel slippage or sliding as the 12% value, okay, because that time we get the high friction. So now see, you can see in the ABS system, okay, in the ABS system maintain because of the adjustment of release and hold adjustment of the car brake, okay, in the ABS system, okay, maintain that 12% sliding, okay, 12% slip rate, okay, the ABS brake, okay, is partially apply the brake, okay, with the 12% slip ratio, okay, So that's why this we can the ABS cars, okay, we can stop the car distance, okay, we can stop the car distance is very short than shorter than the without ABS, okay. The reason is here ABS system, it maintains 12% slip ratio, okay, clear. So it is a normal condition. Okay. This is the ABS, okay. I hope you get clear idea about you got a clear idea about ABS, okay. Now we study about some parking brakes separately. We study about some parking brakes, okay. There are three types of parking brakes, okay. First is, okay, it's very rare this type of parking brakes, okay, mostly used in the high cost car, this means Audi or something, the other cars, okay, these tools, the disc brake, okay, it's very rare type, okay, because the most vehicle parking brakes, okay, the mostly you can see the car in the day life, okay, the both in the front both wheels are disc, okay, the rear wheels are drum, okay. Some of other SUV, for an example Toyota Land Cruiser, so they are available with the with the rear disc, okay, because this disc brake is very effective. So in the racing cars are, okay, available with the disc brakes, all are disc, okay. The normal cars, okay, mostly the rear wheel is drum, both rear wheels are drum brake, the front wheel is disc, okay. So first we study in the type 1 is very rare case, okay, that is all four wheels are disc, okay. So however I told, the rear wheels and the always the parking brake is connected with the rear wheels, okay, always parking brake is connected with the rear wheels, okay. So when you press the parking brake lever, what will happen, this both rear wheels are locked, okay. So first we study about the disc brakes, okay, the rear parking brakes, okay, that are disc, okay. So here you can see the first is with wheel caliper and axle lever attached to a mechanical coxo, okay. There is a coxo device inside the caliper piston, okay. The coxo device is connected inside of the caliper piston. When the parking brake cables pulled on the lever, this coxo device, when we apply the parking brake, this coxo device pushes the piston against the pads, okay. So this is the same thing, you can see here we connect with the cable, okay, here cable is there, okay, cable is connect with the hand brake, okay. Okay, handbrake. Normal time the handbrake is like this, okay, you know. When handbrake is applied, the handbrake is we pull the handbrake, okay. This is a condition. What will happen? You can see here. Here there is a rotor, okay. This rotor. This is the piston, okay. This is the piston. Inside of this piston, this type of parking brake, okay, this type of pistons are there in the parking brake, so, okay. So here this is the coxo, okay, that coxo, this is connect with the piston, so there is a return spring here, okay, and here there is a linkage, okay. Now let's see when apply the parking brake, how this this time parking brake is applied, this time released, okay, piston move this way and that way, okay. Okay, applied, parking brake is released, rear caliper parking brake movement, this is okay. The second thing, so here you can see this type of parking brake, okay, not working with a hydraulic or any air pressure, okay. This handbrake is working by the cable, okay. Okay, when we pull a handbrake, this is the cable. This is not the fully hydraulic line or air pressure. Why? What's the purpose? They can combine the parking brake with the hydraulic or air pressure line, okay. If any emergency case, that time the hydraulic or air line is not working, okay. Hydraulic fluid is some leakage or any working. That time, we have an alternative, another method, okay. That is cable. That is a normal cable. You know that that's clutch cable, the bike cable, that type of accelerator, that type of cable, okay. So, this type of cables is available, okay. This type of cable is available in here. So, here totally is working by mechanically by cable, not a fluid, okay. So there is an alternative. If this hydraulic is not working, we can stop the vehicle by using emergency stop, okay. We can use any emergency condition, we can use this handbrake, okay. So this is a cable, not a hydraulic fluid or any lights, okay. So another brake is there, that is totally drum brake, okay. Oh, here I have to tell, I already told that the floating type, okay, the floating type calibers are this type caliber or something, okay. In this side only one piston, the calibers are there, this like this, eh? This is the caliber, okay. This is the piston, the rotor, only one side caliber, okay, one side piston, okay. This side working with by the caliber movement, okay. So the floating type is called float type. So this type of parking brakes, we can use the single piston floating calibers, okay. In the fixed type, both side, if the fixed type means there's both side have the piston, that type of brakes we cannot use this parking brake, okay. The other thing, this is a normal brake, okay. You all are know this brake, drum brake, okay. Mostly we can see this type of brake, okay, in the vehicle, that is a drum brake, okay. They are say separate cable, okay, in the rear drum brake vehicles. So here you can see, this is the parking brake lever, okay. This is a parking brake strut, okay. Okay, this is the parking brake cable. This is also steel, the normal cable, okay. Okay, button spring link there, lever lock, okay. This mounting fixed here. So when, what happened in the drum brakes, how with the parking brakes works, just see, okay. When we apply the parking brake, okay, because of this linkage, okay, in the normal way in the cars, you can see this type of parking brake. Okay, this type of parking brake, I think you see there is a button, okay? When we apply the parking brake like this, this area, this button is automatically locked, okay? Okay, locked, okay, automatically locked. You can, if you see earlier, this this can break, okay? You get a better idea, okay? It's locked, okay? That time what happened, this cable is pulled, okay? Pull, so because of this mechanism, because this lever, this both this brake shoes extend and lock the tram, okay? See again carefully, okay? Now, and this button is locked, okay? What happened? The pull the cable and this brake shoe is locked, okay? This is a normal brake, normal drum brake, but I want to show the other thing. I want to show another thing here. Here also I have to tell, there are some, okay? Here you can see, this is the rear vehicle. Okay, I already told, some vehicles have the rear disc brake, rear disc brake. They use the disc brake as the parking brake, okay? But here, this is a different type, okay? Mostly you can see these type of brakes in the Sri Lanka. You can see these type of brakes, okay? You can normally in the Biro, or you can see in the Land Cruiser, you can see they both four wheels are disc, okay? So here that type of parking brake is not applied, okay? Disc. Here you can see this is the separate ram, okay? This rear wheels have two types of brakes. This is disc, okay? This disc have a caliper also, okay? The inside of the here, okay, the midpoint of this disc, you see like a small drum, okay? Inside of this drum there is a drum brake, okay? So this rear wheels have combination of disc brake and drum brake. That means this brake is using this, all four disc brakes are using for normal working condition brakes, okay? This drum is only used for the parking brakes, okay? Only this drum is only used for parking brake, okay? Okay, now this, okay, you can see inside of this disc, okay? Inside of this disc, okay, there is a disc, and inside of this disc another small drum. This drum is only used for the parking brake, okay? The parking brake cable is connected with this drum brake, okay? This disc brake are working by the hydraulic fluid, okay? This drum brake is only for parking purpose, okay? Here also we can adjust the same as the drum brake, okay? You can see inside here, this is drum, this is disc, okay? There are two brakes, okay? So we studied the four types of parking brakes, okay? One is single disc brake and single drum brake, and this type of setup, okay? Combination of disc brake and drum brake. And the other thing is pneumatic type parking brakes, eh? We study in the air chamber, okay? Okay, clear. So these are the parking brake system. I clearly explained the four things, okay? Okay, I think I explained all the things in the tutorial part, lab sheet, okay? Next we Okay. Next we see about our practical, okay?